much for having so beautifully expressed the very eloquent words of Dr. Bradford. Thank you so much for joining us. So now it is your time, and this is what we would like to do, just in the interest of giving as many people the opportunity to speak as possible. We would ask that you raise your hand, and then when you are chosen, say your name, but then please do limit the intervention to 1 minute if it's a question or a comment. I'm hoping not to have to ask people to cut off. We will take three at a time and then move on. I do believe already we have a gentleman in the back. Go ahead, and you will be next second. Go ahead, please.
I would like to speak. My name is Raymond Genji. I came from Syria. Regarding the religious leader in the world, I would like to mention one important thing is there were two religious leaders in the world in Aleppo. They were for peacemakers. They did that since 7 years till now. Nobody has announced and nobody has declared, and we don't know anything about them. My teacher, more Gregorius Johanna Rahim, he was working in pluralism, dialogue, and coexistence. And this matter, it is great for us and great for the coexistence. I hope that in this week, the Harmony Week, we can do something for them to let them free, to set them free. Thank you so much.
So my name is Tami Kamtakunda, I am from the Creator God Center of Vienna, and also in friendship and cooperation with the Peace Museum in Vienna. And among all the speeches I really like, when Miss Elizabeth Cook said, peace starts with you. And really that has been a question to me, how to come from the conference room to the level of the individuals, not that we change the law, but we have to change the mind of the people. And that is a big issue. And as a small and humble initiative for this, together with Peace Museum Vienna, our organization, is doing the Peace Walk May 2020 Vienna. It has been some years ago and it will be again. And we don't have a lot of peace walks in Europe, it is quite unique, starting from Stephansplatz for the memory of Bertha von Suttner, who I think all Vienna knows. And we really need more Bertha von Suttners today. We need more Bertha Pangas today. And why did not be one with the one? And so the thing is that crowds can change the thing. I really invite everybody to come and with our numbers to show, yes, we want peace. And with our numbers, our participation, our march, our walk, we will show that, yes, there are enough people who want peace today. Thank you. Thank you.
To both of you for your introductions. Does anybody actually have a question for our panelists? We have a gentleman here.
Okay, Hans Kondor, Unification Church in Austria. We are, well, since 1995, a state accepted belief community. And I wanted to ask a question to Ambassador Ahmad Khan for his 3 points. I could only write down 2. I'm missing one.
Yeah, 3 points about the right of far right. Yeah, so I had given an example of, you know, just an example of what a challenge that far right poses for interfaith harmony. And in our neighborhood, the policies recent, or in the measures recently taken by India, there was a Citizenship Amendment Act, which discriminates on the basis of religion, particularly Muslims. The second was the majoritarianism affecting judicial cases, and there have been some judgments. I refer to 2 judgments. And third was the unilateral action taken by India in Jammu and Kashmir, which is a disputed territory, but there they have had raised the question that these kind of unilateral measures or policies, how can they be, how can they augur well for the interfaith relations? So that was my point.
Thank you so much for having clarified that. Does anybody else have a question for one of our panelists? Now is your moment, don't be shy. Anybody else have a question for, or do you have any comments? Yes, please go ahead.
My name is Hata Maria Tulsi. I'm ambassador for peace 2014-2016. Today we celebrate the 10th anniversary of World Interfaith Harmony Week. The father of Abdullah, King Abdullah of Jordan, was Hussein of Jordan. And he became king in a very tough time. And he was so much, all his life, was lying out in the Palestinian conflict. And so he raised his children in the belief that all religions are the same. You have to respect other religions. If you kill the religion of somebody or take it away, then you have war. You have to respect the persons as they are. And this we should also take with us. This is what my comment. Thank you very much for your time.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much. If nobody else has a burning question, I do, but please, this is your moment. If you have any questions for our panelists or any specific comments. If not, I would like to just take a moment and ask a quick one. Now, straight down the line, starting from Jean-Luc, straight down the line, we talked about extremism. We talked about people going to a very dark side and then end up just losing their ability to remember humanity. This is a really, really critical thing right now, especially when you look at the kinds of weapons systems that we are developing. And so, if I may, I would like to just throw out to the panel, in very brief responses, what ideas do you have for how we can not necessarily stop extremism, but just kind of get elements that are extremely focused on conflict somehow back into a more peaceful area? Impossible question, but if anybody has any feedback, I'd love to hear it.
If you know, because then I will have to leave the room at the first speed up. I mean, it relates to some activities which you have in place, and of course, I mean, the approaches have to be far more holistic than what I will try to suggest at this moment. I read the speaker advice of the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime, but one of the programs which are now incubating, which we're moving forward, assuming that indeed the figures, the estimates that by 2050, in 70% of the world population will be living in the urban area, that will create some set of challenges and problems. Especially if you add to the equations about climate change and more people on the move within the countries to the urban areas. We are now at this moment the working on a program which talks about urban conflicts and urban security. And in that framework, I mean, we do have to acknowledge, I mean, that the strictly law enforcement approaches are absolutely not sufficient to deal with the challenges ahead for us. You need to have, I mean, I think though, in some of the most, let's say, extreme cases, where you not only try to prevent violent extremism, but as well extreme violence. I mean, you think here, Central America, and the work we're doing with gangs, I mean, operating in some of those urban areas. I mean, oftentimes it is like we only have two solutions. I mean, it is our law enforcement cracking down, demand of doing, or on the other hand, a truce, a ceasefire. Then both are insufficient. I mean, what is really is required, I mean, to make sure that you get to the vulnerability of the people, that you accept the fact, I mean, that there are some demands which need to be taken care of, that there are some governance structures which need to be put in place, that if the government is not able to do that themselves, that you can eventually work with the communities, the neighborhoods, to have that in place. While at the same token, not being naive and not assuming, I mean, that there are no criminal elements here around. But oftentimes, and that's something that you really see as well in the United States of America, the most violent actors in this kind of constellations are to be counted on heads. So if you can get the messaging, I mean, the law enforcement, the logistic approach is very much more focused while you lay out, I mean, the foundations to have more equity, to have more balances. I mean, that is something that you will try out very soon, and hopefully in 5 years we'll know what can be the outcome, and I assume it will be positive.
Well, thank you so much for that. Before you run off, I mean, the importance of building capacity for peacemaking on the ground, and how important is interfaith cooperation in that regard? I mean, excellent point. So, as Jean-Luc leaves, may I ask for a round of applause for our wonderful speaker? May I ask if anybody else on the panel would like to respond? Please do.
Yeah, I would like to briefly respond to this question. It's a very interesting question raised by you. And my response is a bit optimistic, because I think as we have seen the rise of extremism or extremist tendencies or radicalism or these kind of forces, but at the same time we have in the international community also seen resentment against these trends. And people are today talking more and more openly against these trends as compared to maybe 2 decades or 3 decades ago. So I think more of a dialogue is the answer. There is no other answer but more of a dialogue between the forces who are in support of pluralism and diversity and interfaith harmony. And we have to rise against, we have to apply more pressure against those forces who are projecting or practicing extremism, unilateralism or unilateral actions, whether these are in the form of states, whether they are in the form of groups, or whether they are in the form of other forces. So that is, to me, I think, that is the only way we can move forward.
Here is a really, really interesting point, is because the necessity to support those who are attempting to change the narrative towards peace. And in essence, that is why we are here, because interfaith cooperation is one huge element of that. So thank you so much, sir. May I ask if we have a second, please?
In my presentation, I said about the voice of extremism is actually much louder, and also because of the role of the media, because it's about themselves, the news. So I think that the media has a role to play. And I think the voice of the moderation should be louder. And if we need to make our voices heard, we need to get it out there. One way of what we do, we need to do is also, I think, the communities at everyone at school level is through education. I think you have to get it at a young age for them to understand and to be able to appreciate one another without seeing color or religion. I think that is the I think it's what the one who said as well, dialogue. I think for Malaysia, we always believe in the importance of having such dialogues, right? Because through dialogues, you can sit together on the table and you can discuss. And of course, when you discuss, it doesn't mean that you need to have an agreement, but it's a process. So at least you have to start the process of trying to get them to understand each other. And the community also plays a very important role. So I think that these are all the elements that I think that we have to address. And I think, and then we will do that.
Once again, thank you so much. And actually, we are definitely going to go to Elizabeth. Before then, I would like to ask you a question, if I may. So the point that you raised is we have to make our voices louder. And that's a very good point. You said via education, dialogue, community. Our first two individuals who gave interventions, for example, I saw our Syrian friend in the background, you held up a book. I'm assuming that is something that has happened. You are having peace marches. May I ask anybody here, what ideas do you have for making our voices louder in terms of promoting interfaith peace, and what have you done?
Yes,
we have the gentleman right here.
Sorry, I'm not the opinion that we have to make our voice louder. My opinion is, if everybody, human, act against other human in the same way, how he like to be acted from others. This is the most important thing. If I act against you, how I like to ask you to act against me, we can be very, not be loud. We can work together, we can discuss together, and so my opinion is, we should not be tolerant. We should not be intolerance. We should accept acceptance. If we say we are tolerant, we are thinking we are better than the other. That's okay, we are tolerant. No, we should accept each other in a friendly way. And this is why I like so much Pakistan. I have a lot of friends in Pakistan since 10 years. And one of Pakistan is a member of our advisory board. And I appreciate very much, really, in Pakistan, you can be a Christian, you can be a Muslim, you can be a Sikh, and this is the way why Pakistan is also growing. We are getting from Pakistan all our embroidery, and thank you very much. I will give you after our clone here that you can see how nice Pakistan is. Thank you very much.
And as you were speaking, both of our esteemed ambassadors were shaking their heads, saying, yeah, that's right, that's right. Now we have time for one other, I'm going to give something for people who have not spoken yet. It will be these two individuals, and then we will finish with words from Elizabeth. And so what are your ideas for increasing the voice?
My name is Mehmet Sekimetin. Thank you for this nice panel. Very nice. Every year I'm also here, many people know me. Yeah, war and peace. My grandfather, he told me every time, my son, when the Mufti from Cairo say our Joseph, and the Pops from Vatican say our Muhammad, till they didn't use this word, we every time war. When they use this word, our, it will be better. And I think now we talk over everything. Why we don't talking over world weapon industry? Why? Why? Peace, we make peace, is nice. Why we don't talk against this weapon industry? Yeah? You make a war in Syria, in Afghanistan, in Pakistan, yeah? You sell them $1 billion weapons, and you talk over peace. I'm sorry, this is not, I don't believe these things, you know, this is only a game, like for children. And the more one thinks, this hurt me, you know, we have about 7 billion human on this world. And over 60 million Kurds. I'm not a national. Yeah? I am also not a religious. Yeah? I am a human being. I look here in this building, yeah, on 212 flag, and not one fled from Kurdistan. Why? 60 million people. That is 600 people, yeah, in Liechtenstein, they have them fled. 1 million people, they have them fled. But 60 million Kurds, they didn't have fled. Why?
192 slaves of the member states.
Yeah. One is the power of the military industrial complex, which goes back to the media, I mean, clearly, because a lot of they own the media, but also. And I have a lot of very good Kurdish friends, you know, and also, you know, how is it possible that a whole group of people somehow is not, you know, is not given the same, you know, awareness? And so I do understand. understand what you're saying. And the hope is that somehow dialogue, again, in education and community can, you know, do something about that. We thank you so much. We have literally just a couple of minutes, and so if you can continue, then we'll finish with you.
I make it quick. My name is Eudora Price. We have a number of organizations in Indiana that do these things like Harmony Week. We have Delta Mensch, the president is here, World People. We have the Flame of Peace, we have the World Federation, and the Peace Museum from the young lady there. I would like to see more cooperation between these three organizations through culture, through religion, because I'm also an evangelist. I'm interested in the clergy and different things. I like to see more togetherness there and more working together, and I think it could be a good thing. Yeah, I sang for the opening, so I know about it, but we need to do more.
You know, that's a really interesting point. It's not only interfaith dialogue, it's the actual organizations.
Exactly.
Need to, you know, structure their communications and their systems to work together.
Yeah,
together.
Not just one day, you know, world manage one day, 1 week. We need to do it continuously, every day.
Yeah. Thank you so much. And now, in our last minutes, Elizabeth, I'm wondering if you could give us a summary, either based on extremism or whatever it is that you'd like to say.
Yes, I would just like to share my personal experience. Of course, it's connected to my work in UPF. And in the University Peace Federation, we create a framework for meeting other cultures and interreligious dialogue, for example, interreligious practice meetings and things. And what I realized that if once you come to know somebody from another culture or the other religion personally, and this person touches your heart, then everything changes. So if you know, my husband and me, we came to know people from Afghanistan, Syria, Pakistan, and became really good friends, and all our worldview changed. And I just thought now, maybe what we can do, if there is a person who really doesn't like another religion, we must find a way to connect this person to somebody from the other religion and support their friendship. And then this hatred would go away, because this is a natural development in heart. You don't want to harm this person anymore, and also not the people around where this person comes from, if you have real friendship with somebody. So, yeah, this is my personal experience. Thank you.
Well, what better way to end than with the heart? So, I very much would like to thank our esteemed panelists for having joined us today. Thank you so much. And there is going to be a fantastic second session coming up very, very quickly. But once again, thank you so much.